Hi, welcome everyone. Welcome to this session on smart cities and safety cities, the digital transformation impact. We are privileged to have a power pack panel today. Let me introduce each of the esteemed guests. To begin with, we have Ms. Sarita Chauhan ma'am, who is the Commissioner of Labor and Employment Department. Welcome ma'am. Also we have Jayati Singh ma'am, who is CEO Gwalior Smart City. We have Ms. Shri Anshul Gupta, who is the CEO Ujjain Smart City. We have Thiru sir, who is Municipal Commissioner Salem Municipal Corporation and representing Salem Smart City. We have Shri Samir Unaraji, Joint Commissioner DMA Maharashtra. We are expecting Atarkar sir to join us soon, who is CEO Srinagar Smart City. We also have esteemed industry players like Nidhi Pandey from HP. She's the CTO for HP. We have Vivek Ogra, who's the leader for transport consulting EY, and Bhavin Shah, who's the regional manager for Western Digital. Welcome everyone. It's a privilege to host you all here for this panel. The agenda, as everyone knows, it's regarding the much talked about digital transformation journey. Its impact on governance, its impact on the way ahead, how cities are going to get transformed riding this digital bandwagon. And we would like to know what the people who are in the thick of it, the administrators, the service providers, the players who enable it, that how we foresee the future and how do we go ahead with it. There's some echo. To begin with, I would like to start with Sarita Chauhan ma'am, take her views on how she views this digital transformation as a tool, as an enabler for better governance, especially with her experience in labor and employment related to issues that are probably about the migrant laborers. We have seen a lot of migration to and fro twice or thrice during this pandemic. With situation changing in JK, there is a lot of employment now expected to be generated. How she thinks that, you know, how technology has enabled government in, you know, dealing and facilitating this better. Ma'am, over to you.
Yeah, good afternoon to all of you. And thank you, Mr. Sharma, for the introduction. It is my privilege to be among some of the people who have actually brought about these changes or are working on it, and talking to them as both an administrator as well as somebody representing people, maybe sections, which I will elaborate further, with expectations from the people who are as of now in the thick of the things, whether it is Ujjain Smart City or Srinagar Smart City or any other places where administrators are. I am at present looking after the Labor and Employment Department, and I am here not only representing the department, but as an administrator who has for some time worked with the Urban Development Department. And all of us in administration, in fact, we got this opportunity to be working with transforming of the cities, or whether it is in the development authorities or in municipal corporations, what are the views that they hold. So to begin with, I would say that the process of building up smart cities has well begun. And smart, as we all know, is something which is, as I perceive, is something that is responsive in the context of a city, and something that is responsive and something we are actually what is there in the topic, which is safe. So a city that is safe, city that is responsive, is a city that we all aspire to live in, that gives us a sense of good life, and it also gives us a sense of being part of this city, and we can contribute to the city if we have the right kind of technology enabled services provided in the city. So far as the labor and employment department is concerned, let me tell you, we all saw during 2020 the situation that unfolded before us all, and it was nobody's fault. It was an unusual situation, unprecedented situation that we all were faced with. And what we saw was that we were least prepared for dealing with the problems of our labors. Although in the labor department, what we are concerned more with is the implementation of the labor laws, which is the regulations. But this is, of course, as part of welfare of the labor, a very relevant aspect that we in the government are looking at as to how well are we prepared to be responsive to the labor. And we find that a lot needs to be done. But then it is not the responsibility of a department alone. And basically, a city represents a melting pot of all sections of the society. It has got all different occupational sectors, whether it is labor or whether it is a white collar job. And as an entity that urban areas have become over the last few decades, where all these civic amenities as well are also looked after by bigger corporations, it essentially comes down to a local body or a local government as it exists in the municipal corporations to be taking care of all sections of its society and providing them the necessary required for a decent and dignified living. But without taking much of your time, I would say that my emphasis and my expectations would also be in particular concerned with the women, children, and the poorer sections of the living in the city. It is important that these sections are taken care of when we put the technology to use. Women at home, when they step out of the home, and all issues pertaining to their safety and living an easy life or living a life that is dignified, which is self-sufficient, which is also, which provides them this confidence of being equal citizens in the city. So with these words, I would like to, put down my expectations as administrator also and as also a citizen of a city, and expect the IT enablers to factor in these concerns when they design smart cities, which has the element of equality and access to all sections of the society. Thank you.
Great. Agreed, ma'am. I think that's a very pertinent point, that city, when it grows when the weaker and the all the sections of the citizens are growing with them. And what better use we can have of technology if it can't be an enabler to do this? I think, and very rightly emphasize that a municipal corporation and local urban local body is the one who can deliver maximum impact. Let me bring in Athar Amir Khan, sir, while we are on the topic. Sir, yeah, we would like to know how you are looking at the Srinagar Smart City, as ma'am said, how are you looking at collaborating with citizens, and also with the current scenario, how difficult is with the newly formed UTs, the structural changes, has the vision and the strategy changed for the smart city, and how you're coping with that, and how is technology being the key enabler for it?
Thank you so much. First of all, I'll start with the last question that you asked. You know, how has the structure changed as far as the UT is concerned? I think it is the kind of accountability, the kind of push that's there from say the mission directory, that's from the government, that is quite increased, and which has in many ways helped us streamline things on ground and get things executed on ground. See, because whenever we are working in cities, one of the major issues and major challenges in most of the places, especially in the cities where municipal corporations are in that transition, is that of the coordination. We still in a city like Srinagar, there are still a lot of functions which are being looked after by different departments, which otherwise should have been with the municipal corporation. Many of these functions have recently been transferred to the municipal corporation. So this thing has happened that as a local body, the municipal corporation has become more capable and more in a way with better capacity. This is also directly helping us in, as far as the implementation of Smart City program in Srinagar is concerned. So the coordination issues we have been able to overcome those issues. Now things are flowing in a more smoother way. As far as the topic of this panel discussion is concerned, how do we build smart and safe cities through the digital transformation? So I'll just try to give a little bit of an idea about what we are doing here in Srinagar as far as the IT interventions are concerned under Srinagar Smart City. The first and the most important project that every smart city is implementing is that of the ICCC, the Integrated Command and Control System. Control center. We're building ICCC for Srinagar City, but with a capability and capacity to in fact have and implement projects and in fact provide services to a geographical area far bigger than Srinagar City. So what we are doing in that ICCC, we are setting up for our own say data center, a network operation center, a communication center, along with a multi-modal command center, which could be used for service delivery during the regular times, as well as for disaster management. In a city like Srinagar, which falls in the seismic zone 5, as well as is very very common as far as floods are concerned and other disasters are concerned, what we have tried to do is that along with the disaster management, the State Disaster Management Authority, we have integrated our ICCC with the what's going to be developed as State Emergency Operations Center. And we're also envisaging that in the immediate future, our ICCC should also act as an emergency operation center. The decision support system, whether it's in terms of forecasting the flood situation or the snow related, or even for that matter, fire and other disasters. So that integration we have done. So in a way, this ICCC is going to be one of the essential elements as far as the disaster management of the city is concerned. So that's number one. Number two, along with the ICCC, what we have also done is we have also taken certain IT projects. For example, we are doing this GIS mapping of the city, in which every property, every establishment in the city is being mapped and properly geofenced. So how this is going to help us is that, for example, if tomorrow there's a fire in a particular place X, the moment there's an incident created from that place X, our system knows what is the exact location. The system automatically finds out which one is the nearest police station, which one is the nearest fire service station, where is the nearest police station, where nearest hospital, where is the nearest emergency vehicle. So that the response time to a particular incident that could be drastically reduced. This is similarly, for example, if there's a physical violence case anywhere, this could again help us reduce that the time of response from the first responders, whether it's police or any other agency. What could take hours, we can reduce that to minutes. That's one objective that we are working on. Then third important part as far as the city is concerned, when we are talking about safe cities, one of the biggest elements is that of traffic management. So we know the number of accidents, and we also know, we see whenever we go to any city, whether if a pedestrian is able to cross a particular junction or not, whether we are able to move and move on, or say whether it is through an ambulance or a car to a hospital, how safe it is, how easily we can reach there. That traffic management, again, we have taken up aggressively in the Smart City project. We are implementing this project in two parts. The first one, we call it as ATCS, Adaptive Traffic Control System, which is a basic. We are having these traffic lights placed at 66 of our junctions in the city. And along with these traffic lights, we have also placed these ATCS cameras, which mostly do queue detection in a little smart way. So these cameras get to know what is the queue length of the traffic, or what is the queue length in a particular arm of a junction. And based on that, it calibrates and it kind of allocates time to different junction, different arms. And the idea is to optimize and reduce the wait time at a junction. Then in the next phase, this first phase we have already implemented, and we are in the process of commissioning this adaptive traffic control system for the city. In the second phase, we are implementing the IT, intelligent traffic management system, which goes a little advanced to it, in which every junction and every arm will have its own ANPR, automatic number plate recognition systems, all the PTZ cameras and others. So this will help us immensely in the enforcement part. So if somebody is jumping the queue, if somebody is jumping the traffic light, we can know which vehicle it is, and then as automatic chalaning is happening, as is being done in most of the other, in some of the other cities, I'm not sure whether it's done everywhere, but in many other cities it's being done. So that's similarly the junctions, because cameras are there, it's also a good way of surveillance from the security point of view. So any untoward incident, that if unfortunately, God forbid, that happens, that could be captured, and it will help the enforcement agencies in that respect as well. So this traffic management system, again, we are heavily banking upon the smart city to ensure to help us out with the traffic management. But again, when it comes to traffic, it's not only the lights and the cameras that help. Along with it is the other parallel projects which go. For example, we have a project of the geometrical improvement of the junctions. So many of these junctions, they are designed and they're there in such a way that having a junction is creating a problem than not having a junction. So again, under that project, we are kind of redesigning many of these junctions with an objective and with an idea that the city needs to be pedestrian friendly. Srinagar is a tourist city. There are a lot of places people visit and people want to visit. So how do we make it more safe for the pedestrians? That's one more objective thing that we are trying to do. And in the end, the as far as IT interventions is concerned, we have also designed, and in fact it's this app called as My Srinagar app. And this app is a one-stop app. The idea behind this is that we want this app to become the face of the government. We want this app to be the like the Amazon is the marketplace. The Amazon app becomes the marketplace. We want this My Srinagar app to become the government for people. So what we have done is that in this app, we are integrating all the services of all the different departments. So they need not be specific to what municipal corporation or smart city is offering or what the district administration is offering. Even the other line departments, they have their services. For example, tourism department has some services. The social welfare has the services. As our ma'am, Sarita ma'am just said, labor department has many other services, and different other power department has some services. So we're integrating all those services into a one common platform, calling it as one-stop solution, calling it as My Srinagar app. This app is being powered in the background by our ICCC's the computing capabilities, which is making it more robust. And this is also integrated with our GIS mapping of the city, which makes the service delivery again very, very, very foolproof and very robust. So we want that this app should become the government for the city, just like an Amazon or a Flipkart used to become the marketplace where you don't go to the shop, you do it. Similarly, people should not feel a need to visit any office, any corporation office, any ward office, or any department for that matter. To whatever extent possible, they should be able to avail services within this. We have already integrated around 40 of these services. Whether you have to apply for building permissions, you can do it on this app. You don't need to come, you don't need to go anywhere. You want to apply for birth certificates, for registrations, you want to raise grievances, you want to file RTIs, you want to require any other services, you want to apply for a power connection, you want to pay your power bills, you want to apply for water connections, you want to even apply for an NOC or you want to get a marriage certificate, that we are also trying to integrate with it. So going forward, our sense is that with this app as the face of the government and face of the city to the people, and powered by our in the back end with our ICCC and with integration of this GIS mapping, this should create a better infrastructure and a system which will help us provide services in a better way. Thank you so much.
That's quite an impressive list of initiatives I think Srinagar is taking up, and looks to be heavy on collaboration with citizen with the all-round app that is being planned. With that, I think we can look at other cities. I would invite Jayati ma'am to help us understand how is Gwalior doing with the smart city ecosystem much more developed and evolved around in and around Gwalior. How is Gwalior looking at implementing newer initiatives, taking this digital transformation to new end, and what's the role of smart governance, I would say, into it. We would like to hear your thoughts, ma'am.
Am I visible and audible to everyone?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, wonderful, wonderful. So we'll start now. My sincere regards to all the panel members and my special compliment to Srinagar Smart City, which has organized this wonderful event for all of us to come forward and collaborate. In the interest of time, I will right away start with the work that we are doing under Smart City Gwalior and how the initiatives have brought about a digital transformation and helped us to make our city safer, more efficient in terms of service delivery, in terms of general operation of different modules or the services that we call. It may be traffic, it may be energy, it may be some sort of heritage conservation and how tourism, etc., how we have worked in those fields. So ICCC, of course, Athar has spoken in detail about how ICCC has been a pivotal feature in combating COVID in different cities and also in terms of disaster management of different nature. It may be flood or any other disaster which the city may have seen in last couple of months since ICCC was initiated, or any other integration of service. It may be procurement of food grains in the city, etc. How a single platform unification is working for providing different services to the citizens. So ICCC in Gwalior has been a very, very important element in combating both first wave and second wave of COVID. We just were able to start right about the time when the first wave of COVID came in Madhya Pradesh, which was somewhere around April and May in Madhya Pradesh. So here, COVID became a focal point for all departments. It was health, it was ancillary other services related to health, it was police, it was Nagar Nigam, it was also many private doctors and citizens who connected with us to combat COVID, etc. So we were able to provide a single platform for everyone. In terms of this, just very quickly, I'd like to point out that we at ICCC, at Smart City, were able to develop a single platform wherein we started from the daily reporting of COVID cases, as in the report for testing of COVID we were able to receive through our single platform. These reports were in turn sent out to different field functionaries. In every, we had incident commanders who were constituted over zones of Gwalior. Our city was divided into different zones, and for every zone, we had a team working headed by incident commander, as we call them. So from daily report generation to pushing of those cases to bucket of incident commander, so that they were aware in their zone how many positive cases were there that day. Then a diagnosis was carried out. Incident commander had a team where he had ward doctor with him, who were able to speak with people or visit people and visit positive patients and see their situation. They were able to do a preliminary diagnosis, basis which we were able to either home isolate them or move them into hospitals. Again, when we started moving them to hospitals in the beginning, we faced a problem that the number of beds in hospital, the situation was really not clear. So what would happen? Let's say there was a hospital A in which 10 beds were empty, but all incident commanders would try to move their patients to hospital A, which in turn resulted in a lot of confusion, which in turn resulted in patients being moved here and there. So we were able to develop a real-time bed availability status for our city, where we brought about medical college, we brought about district hospitals, we brought about even 80-85 private hospitals. We were able to give a very real-time availability of bed status in the city. It was available not only to incident commander, but also to general public as well on our VMS and other monitoring system. So that was a very strong feature of the whole single platform on which we operated in COVID. And from that point, we were able to move them to hospitals through ambulance managements. We had ambulance who were lined up here in Smart City Control Room, And the moment we were able to identify the number of people who were to move to hospital, the ambulance will in turn move accordingly. We're dispatched from here, and across the night, over a period of 6 to 7 to 8 hours, we were able to carry out the entire movement to hospital. And then we were able to follow them up with hospital after their discharges. We were able to do a 14-day follow-up. And also for people who were home isolated, we were able to have an efficient medicine delivery system. Many organizations here had come forward. They had started giving out a pulse oximeter to the patients who were at home. We were able to do a video calling with those patients at least once a day. We were able to demonstrate how medicines are to be taken, correct use of pulse oximeter. We also had a monitoring system on which we were calling them twice a day. It was all done so as to quickly identify if people at home, their situation is deteriorating. So before, you know, we reached that critical point, we were able to diagnose it and we were able to move them to hospital. So ICCC in COVID has done a very, very wonderful role here. And it is not at all an exaggeration if we say that we have managed to save literally thousands of life through our young and able team at ICCC, which worked seamlessly for multiple days at end. One of the most important work that we had done was oxygen management, of course. So while we had incoming oxygen in our city, but since we told that we had over 100 hospitals which were operating and catering to COVID patients, ranging from a nursing home or a private clinic which we had used to medical college, the efficient distribution of oxygen supply and demand management was very, very essential. Because in the beginning, when we had smaller number of cases, we were able to do it efficiently. But then later on, when the demand also went up, we had people who had 16-liter and 30-liter, then we had to do it very seamlessly. We had to do it very efficiently, and we had to do it in a very scientific manner. So we were able to use ICCC in oxygen management very, very efficiently. And my team, literally, when the crisis saturated, peaked, they worked for days on ends without even going home on multiple occasions. Again, in July of this year, we had a flood situation in Gwalior and in adjoining areas, which through ICCC, we were able to efficiently handle the relief distribution work, whereas other disaster control work was done through ICCC. So in addition to, of course, on basis of providing public delivery to system to people of the city, we have efficiently used ICCC in multiple disasters which we had to face in last 1.5 years. Now moving on, we are also talking about Safe City. One of the most important projects that we have done and we are also in the process of implementing is the LED smart LED light project, wherein before undertaking the project, we have done an elaborate survey of the city. There are many black hole or many areas where we were able to, as per data from police, where we were able to identify a lot of crime and a lot of antisocial activities were being carried out in some places during day, in some places during night. And many of these were poorly lighted or were poorly connected with city. So as part of our smart energy integration process, we were able to provide those infrastructure facility. We were also able to provide CCTV coverages in those areas to connect it to our control room. So we can keep continual monitoring. And it has resulted. Also, there's a scheme of Government of India under Nirbhaya with which we had conversed, which has resulted really in providing safety to these cities. Moving on, another feature of Safe City is, of course, ITMS, which many cities have done, which is Integrated Traffic Management System. As part of this system, so in Gwalior and in Gwalior Chambal area, we did not have people following traffic rules diligently, and the violations, speeding is a norm. In fact, if we are to look at the number of accidental deaths data in Madhya Pradesh, Gwalior is among top 5. So as a result of ITMS project, it has brought about one of the most important features is very strong element of behavioral change in people. So now we would see people jump red lights and tripling and all those violations were very frequent. But with introduction of ITMS and with each alarm generation, we are finding out of significant behavior in people who are using roads And this has been documented by a major university here. Also, the e-challan system has brought about a mindset change also. We, as part of ITMS, we have done multiple campaigns and we have done multiple workshops also. So we are finding people are adhering to rule more and more, and it has significantly resulted in drop in accidents in our city. Again, moving on, another feature that we have done as part of our safety campaign is, of course, ECB, which is the emergency calling box. So at multiple locations, we, as part of our ITMS project only, we have introduced emergency call boxes. There were a couple of incidents here where which were very which received a lot of infamous publicity, where women citizens were behaved improperly, and the response time due to certain factors was not as it should have been. So as a result of this whole women safety campaign, we have started the ECB feature, wherein we have put in these calling devices at multiple locations in the city, and also converged it, like I told, with the areas where which were black spots. So as in case any citizen who is in need of immediate assistance from control room, from police, from ambulance, these call boxes can be used. And as a result of this, we get an immediate call to our operator in control room. He's able to talk to people through calling boxes, identify what sort of assistance that they need, and immediately dispatch it to people. So it has been a very important element in our effort to make our city safer, in our effort to make our city safer for women citizens also. Now, moving on, of course, many cities have these features. We have Sutra Seva bus services. The whole prior to that, we only had private operators who were plying in our city. With introduction of Sutra Seva, which is a Madhya Pradesh government scheme, wherein we give some amount of subsidy for operators to come in and ply their buses, we have been able to bring a very good standard of public transport. We, as part of many software interventions, we have added many emergency features. We have added a GPS location. We have added all those features to make public transport safe, to make the public transport reliable, and to enhance the level of service delivery that we provide to people. In addition to this, we have also started now having a women conductor in our buses, which have been a very positive feature from a point of empowerment of young girls and young women into our public transport system as well. Moving on, another feature that we have done is smart classes and smart schools. So as a result of this, we have been able to introduce digitally transform the way education, the way learning, etc., is carried out in school. We have furnished almost 30 to 37 schools here as part of the whole smart class campaign, and we have been able to add not only content which is able to help them to learn better, but we have been able to improve delivery of knowledge to these students. Various interactive platforms, etc., have been added as per their progressive level of learning. Various features have been added, so that is also another feature which is being much appreciated also. Apart from this, to promote tourism, as part of Bolia Smart City, we have undertaken many initiatives. Of course, the premise or the whole building block of Gwalior Smart City has been the heritage work that we have done in our city. As part of this, we have taken a heritage area which was under urban municipal corporation. We have retrofitted, redeveloped the whole area, and brought in various digital elements. For example, a digital museum and planetarium is another very visible and very publicized and award-winning project that we have done here, wherein the entire history of Gwalior Chamber area is being showcased, not only by means of physical artifact, but also digitally by means of various documentaries and stories that have been created. We have been able to bring in many artisans. We have been able to develop many backward linkages with such people, and we have been able to do that project and highlight history of this area in a very, very positive way, while bringing in tourism, while bringing in footfall to these monuments, also while bringing a new life to that particular area, and also collaborating with lot of individuals who actually contribute to the softer culture aspects of the city. Similar elements is another.
Yeah, with this impressive lineup of so many initiatives that you have clubbed, I think this has been great. Thing where you feel that digital transformation has impacted a particular factor in so many initiatives that Gwalior has taken? Like one I could see was the COVID platform that was turned up through using the leveraging the ICCC. Is there any other example that you would like to put?
So what happens is that every project that we do has a digital component. So, for example, we talk about a museum wherein we have gone on to, of course, the physical display of artifacts, but also digital display of artifacts. Similarly, planetarium or another, every project that we do, or the digital library that we develop has a IT component and has a civil component. In that ways, for example, if we have to talk about digital literacy, not only we have worked on improving digital learning in school, but we have also developed a digital library here, wherein which is very much an automated feature. Students can come in, sit around, they can you know, automatic issuance of books, etc. So we've added those features. ITMS is, of course, another feature. So previously, we would have manual challenge generation, but as part of ITMS, we have a non-invasive and automated artificial intelligence-based system wherein we are generating challenge. For example, if we had talked about smart LED feature, everything is integrated with ICCC. So previously, what used to happen in a lighting, public lighting system is that you will go, you will manually turn on the LED lights or whatever lights that you have in the city, and basis that the whole system will work. But as a result of integration with ICCC, at 6 every day in evening, the whole setup would start working. So it has brought about strong amount of digital integration, and it has brought about lot of savings in terms of manual intervention, saving in terms of, you know, inefficiencies that develop into the system due to this manual intervention. So it has brought about significant digital transformation in city as part of the digital projects that we are doing.
Great, that's some great ecosystem that Gwalior has developed. I mean, on the same lines, we would like to hear from Thiru sir, how Salem is looking at what are the digital accelerators that the city is going to leverage or is planning to leverage to compete with other major cities in the region and overall in the country. Sir, if you could shed some light on what kind of initiatives that you are looking at. Hello, am I audible? Thiru sir, can you hear us?
Yes, Aditya, you are audible.
Believe we can't hear us. Moving on, would like to hear from Samir sir about work done in Maharashtra. I think DMA in Maharashtra has been at the forefront when it's about municipal reforms and implementing e-governance systems there. Sir, how do you see the importance or the factor of technology? How do you think this is going to help in smart governance and in better municipal administration? If you could shed throw some light and share your thoughts on it.
Sir, good afternoon. I am from Salem.
Yes.
Yeah. Our CEO sir is in minister meeting, another meeting.
Okay.
Another meeting. So I am an executive engineer in Salem Corporation. Okay. Yeah. In our panel discussion, we can move.
Yeah. Please go ahead. I mean, if you can.
Yeah. Okay. Answer. In our panel discussion is in smart cities and safe cities digital transformation impact. Correct. So in our Salem Corporation, so many projects taken for our digital transformation under Smart City Mission, especially LED streetlight monitoring system by CCMC for checking glowing LED or not. Whether it is not glowing, it is easily identified by using the CCMC and easily resolved it. And one main thing is ICCC Integrated Command Control Center for live in Salem Smart City. By using this IEEE C, day-to-day operation, citizen grievance, expectation handling, and it's called for City Nerve Center. It will act in both situations. Proactive and reactive will truly make the city operation smarter. By using this IEEE C, centralized monitoring application for IoT devices also installed, smart pole, smart street lights, public address systems, emergency call box, city surveillance systems, and variable message signboards are installed in by using this IEEE C. And why IEEE C means, example, the population of city is around 5.5 million with the area of 326 square kilometer. To cater the city, the task force of more than 17,000 employees has been in place by SEMC. The budget of SEMC is more than 5,000 crore to monitor the manage the huge task. It is required to have a centralized system which can help the city administrators for efficient decision making. By benefits for IEEE C are achieved, SEMC center is beneficial to SEMC. It helps identification of abnormal events and take corrective actions. Cross-department collaboration will help improve quality of services. Early identification of complaint will help in early resolutions. So this is the benefits for using this digital transformation. And safety purpose means, by using solid waste management, data from GPS trackers enabled waste collection vehicles of municipal corporation, which have conveyed covering all area of city, will serve main objectives of real-time monitoring. We route replay of vehicles and planning for optimization of operations based on the historical, some key features. And another case is the implementation of D2E's cases is all the 1,500 vehicles are fitted with the GPS and the live feed can be viewed at IEEE C dashboard. Some key activities at IEEE C means monitoring the availability of door-to-door vehicles, trip not started. In case trip not started, in case vehicles do not start trip, inform concerned sanitary inspectors or SSI to make alternative arrangements and to inform concerned SSI for arrangement. Next one is a monitor RFID-based wave bridge application deployed at all transfer stations. Prepare, produce MIS reports to officers in charge in solid waste management department. So these are the safety purpose in our smart city to take a digital transformation. And outcome of door-to-door system is a number of complaints from citizens have been reduced. Prompt action for missed garbage collection points, real-time monitoring leads to efficient route management, updating of routes as soon as required, enables accurate and automated weighting and transformation. And these are the IEEE C functions using. And there are so many cameras, CCTV cameras are fitted in the important areas in Salem City for traffic and crime for safe cities. And another one is implementation of integrated air pollution and monitoring system. By using this air monitoring device to know the actual pollution in atmosphere, this device is high performing and highly integrated air pollution environment monitoring system. It will monitor weather and environmental parameters such as temperature, relative humidity, sound pressure, and ultraviolet and light, etc. And another one is implementation.
Sir, while these initiatives are there, we understand Salem is doing a lot of it. What is the direct impact on citizens? One small example, if you can cite. Initiatives across smart cities are more or less around
Yes, sir. One example is implementation of 10 bus shelters, number of bus shelters implemented in Salem City under smart city mission. It's public can safely wait, get well acquainted of bus arrival at bus stops, smart power sockets to power cells, and the safety on passengers is ensured during the day, night hours, rainy days, etc. Fleet management is ensured. Also by surveillance, public safety is ensured. So many cameras in CCTV cameras are installed for safe cities by using the digital transformation impact.
Great.
Yes.
I think one central theme is IEEE C is playing a key role in these cities.
Yes.
Smart governance more pertinent.
Yes.
I would like to hear from, I'm moving on to Ujjain Municipal Corporation and Smart City. Anshul Gupta, sir, if you can shed some light on not only these initiatives, we've heard Smart City is doing a lot of tech initiatives. What it also generates is a lot of data. And how Ujjain plans to deal with it? Are there any initiatives taken around it? How do you plan to make the governance more citizen friendly? If you can shed some light.
Thanks, Aditya. Thanks for having me here. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. You are.
Yeah, so first of all, thanks Srinagar Municipal Corporation and Smart City for organizing this event and giving all of us an opportunity to interact and brainstorm. I would not repeat those things which already my colleagues from different parts of India have already discussed. As all of us are doing ICCC and many of us are doing ITMS also, which we are also doing. My colleague from Gwalior, Jayati, discussed about the COVID dashboard and solution, which was done here as well. A few things which which have not been discussed till now, I think. So one thing which we are doing and many other cities are also doing is Smart Class. So Smart Class is a solution where e-delivery of content, both in online and offline mode, has been tried. And interactive digital boards have been made. Right now, municipality runs some schools, so it has been tried only in those schools and not in the education department schools. But this has a scope of scaling up. One thing which I see with all of our ICT initiatives is that at times technology moves forward, then we move forward. So like Smart City, that Smart Class solutions were envisaged few years back. And now with the advent of cheap data, and especially during COVID times when online learning happened on large scale and there are so many e-learning setups all across the universe, then maybe a more prudent approach could be that we give students access to a device and plus data, and rather than setting up the full-fledged smart classrooms in the schools, because there is an O&M cost involved in that also. A very important issue with the smart class is content to be in vernacular, because many of the service providers are firms which have been providing this K-12 solutions to the private schools. And at times, content may not be in vernacular. Thirdly, we should be able to see what value it is adding to the already content being delivered by the teacher in this classroom. So if it's just a PPT or if it's just a, you know, kind of reader over a text, then it doesn't add much value. So as you say, the picture is worth 1,000 words and a video is worth 1,000 pictures. In those way, smart class solutions can be implemented going forward. Another thing is that smart class solutions have been conceptualized mostly by the smart cities. So our end user, be it student or be it teachers, they need to be taken on board, which has happened in places, which has not happened in places. As far as ICCC is concerned, ICCC has created a wonderful infrastructure, and you have a complete set of systems, servers, bandwidth, processing capacity, a video wall. But I think many cities, even including ours, we are still to figure out how can we optimally utilize the capacity developed. And there are different sets of applications and different sets of apps which have been developed over the years, and they are on different platforms. And how do we integrate them, and how do they the data move seamlessly from one to another? So for example, we also do many, like municipal corporations do many social functions, like we will give pension to the old and disabled, and then we'll issue death certificates. So for example, if you issue a death certificate, then automatically that person's name should be struck off from your citizen database and wherever you are giving the pension. Right now, that seamless integration of data from one database to another is not happening. And as I see that ma'am from Labor Department is also there. So the same thing, like, you know, that same person may be benefiting from the Labor Department benefits also, which are mostly on the similar lines across states. So and all these softwares and apps have been developed by different agencies with different front end, back end over different parts of time. But the design integrity has to be kept in mind. And maybe that is where the role of smart city comes in. One very important thing which we have tried to do here in Ujjain Smart City is GPS tracking of all the vehicles. So like we have door-to-door collection facility for the garbage, like many other cities. And there are really, really frequent complaints that vehicles are not reaching time, or it's not spending enough time at its designated location, or its timings are irregular, or just veered off its path. So then we did a geofencing of each vehicle, their location, and now such complaints can be addressed, and what you call a data-enabled decision making. So we are able to see that, you know, if a vehicle is standing at certain point for a long period of time, then something is amiss. Or what kind of mileage a vehicle is deriving, or if a vehicle is covering its route too fast, then we know that, you know, it's missing some houses. So that kind of thing is happening that kind of thing is doing. Okay. We are doing it, but ITMS has an issue that, you know, the transport department and the police department and the smart city and IT, they all need to work in conjunction. So that piece of puzzle, and then after, once you check, you are doing in a non-obtrusive way, you are doing the traffic, preventing traffic violation, instead of, you know, somebody standing on the road and then checking everybody. So that's a very smart and non-obtrusive way of doing things. But after that, the penalty, the challan, which we call in colloquial terms, the fine amount and that thing, so that remains. And then why would somebody pay that challan when you send it over SMS or email? That remains an issue. Apart from this, what we are trying now is we are trying to do a end-to-end integration of our sanitation-related works. So like, we have mapped how many septic tanks we have in the city. So we have something around 70,000 septic tanks. And we have made the city litter bin free, but there are litter bins in commercial areas, and there are complaints that, you know, they are over, they are at times the cleaning is irregular, or something is the bin is filled but somebody is not cleaning it. So now we are planning, and apart from that, we have something around 100 community toilets. Some of them are maintained by Sulabh and other partners, and some of them are maintained directly by the municipal corporation. So now a solution which we are implementing is we are putting a QR codes over all the litter bins and over all the public community toilets and all the septic tanks. Now, what we are doing is that, you know, every septic tank has a time period, a frequency at which it has to be cleaned, 2 years or 3 years, depending on its size and capacity and the number of people in the household which are using it. So once that period is over, on a simple app, the household can simply scan the QR code and we'll get an alert at our head office. And then we can send a team to clean that up. Other thing which also happens, that our team which goes and which cleans a particular septic tank, so it will also, you know, scan that QR code, so that data will generate, okay, that they have cleaned. The similar thing will operate for litter bins as well as the CTPTs. So if they are not cleaned, or if somebody wants to raise a concern, so he or she can raise a concern by scanning the QR code over the app. And our team, whenever it reaches to clean it, they have to also update that they have cleaned it. And this also they can do via the handheld devices which will be provided to them, plus the scan the QR code over the app. So this is one thing which we are trying to implement. From this, a very important component which I think all of us, the local bodies, need to dwell more upon is the digital payment part. So after the Digital India and the demonetization and Jan Dhan, the local body tax collection and fee collection, those things, I think we need to give a larger push for the e-payment, because at many times state governments have their payment portals and local bodies have their different payment portals, and because our volumes are lower compared to the state governments, so getting favorable deals from the payment partner mechanisms can be an issue. So like, for example, here we have tied up with HDFC, and they have provided us with the handheld POS machines, which all our tax collectors, be it the tax collectors on the property tax and be it tax collectors on the, you know, these temporary shops, they all of them are using. But I think there's a policy push that, you know, detailed payments of tax get some kind of waiver, 1%, 2%, 5%, that might push citizenry more towards the digital payment. So, and that obviously has its benefits, that goes without saying. Apart from that, citizen services which citizen want to access, be it, you know, applying for a birth certificate or death certificate or marriage certificate, and accessing different social security benefits. So right now, the architecture here in Madhya Pradesh and in like Ujjain is that we have this so-called Lok Seva Kendra. The idea is that, you know, public should not come to the offices, but we have made this modern kind of centers where they are operators and they can apply for
a N number to enable them, I think.
Services. Yeah, so basically these are the IT things which we are doing, and I think we all should think about how we can push more delivery of access of public services in the digital domain. And once we do that, these different services and their database, they should be talking to each other so that we can have some kind of BI, business analytics applications. And one set of data makes the other set of data meaningful and helps decision makers in making evidence-based decision making.
Agreed, sir. On that note, I think let's bring in some industry perspective to this discussion. I would like to bring in Nidhi. Nidhi, we heard all these cities implementing various kinds of initiatives, whether it is to IEEE, whether it is to citizen collaboration, into GIS-based mapping, GPS coordinates, and basically a lot of interconnected devices on the circuit. How do you see a player like HPE coming into this, enabling all these administrators to deliver it better? What is the way forward? How will you look at it?
Thanks, Aditya, first of all, for inviting me to this. And thanks all to all the panelists for sharing. With respect to what we are doing in smart cities, it is really overwhelming to hear how we are using technology and how government is actually serious about leveraging technology to make more and more digital, to make that whole dream of digital India realized. So like you said, what HPE is doing, I representing HPE as a part, initiatives that we are talking about around it, HPE's commitment to Digital India and the Smart Cities Initiative is so strong. We have presence in more than 45 Smart Cities initiatives, either as, as a component or as in almost or approximately a dozen. We even play the master services integrators role. So the IEEE that I keep hearing about, and I'm almost each of the cities that we heard about has been advocating the benefits of having ICC in place and how this is helped in, when pandemic struck in, when some kind of calamity struck in, how the municipal corporations have come together, the government bodies have come together to make it work. So this is where what HPE has been also, being a major contributor around. What is the need is the digital infrastructure and the physical infrastructure start integrating for any pieces around traffic, waste management, surveillance, or anything that we talk about around this, or municipal citizen services. So that's where we have realized the problems that the smart city actually aims to solve, and that's why we have our own course, Smart City Reference Blueprint, which is where we are recommending mandatory inclusions of that modular and scalable ecosystem is what we need to go for. We should have IoT layers. We should talk about the big data platform within that. We should have open data API layer, advanced analytics layers, and technologies supporting these integrations. Very quick and easy way of integrating with external systems. As we heard there are digital services. There are already services that are digital. However, smart services do not make a smart city. What really makes a smart city is how these pieces come together and what we are doing about with these smart cities, which is where I heard this one of the panelists recommending on the point around that we consolidate these services, integrate and leverage data from to influence probably decisions on other services, which is how the way more towards data-based decision making. That's where again we we understand the issues that would come around this, and that's why we have our own big data and analytics practices, which looks at having these kind of plugs from different kind of data sets and all, and bringing them together and making them useful for a data scientist to work on, so that the models can be rendered, which can be actually used. So that's how HPE has generically been talking about. If you start looking at the company's vision and the drivers that we talk about, we are fully committed. We talk about an edge to cloud world. With a database decision making. So there is a lot of things that we are talking about in terms of bringing these building blocks together, for which we already have reference blueprints. The one additional piece that partners like HPE can bring in, which would be beneficial, as we understand, for all these initiatives, there the start is always a small start. So you start small and then you start onboarding services. Then you start, expanding the reach by probably going into remoter areas and extending those services. What this essentially does is this increases the whole power in terms of computing and storage and analytical capabilities that we would need. That's where players like us have unique proposition that we come across, that we unbundle everything as a service for this sector, which is when we talk about smart services, one of the tenets that we important tenets is citizens. And when we talk about citizens and their data, the security and privacy become very, very inherent to the whole scheme of things. That's mm-hmm. where this everything as a service, where the cloud comes to the door, actually is a proposition that HP brings in. And like I said, we've been engaged in a lot of smart cities already. So we are privy and even partner to a lot of these initiatives. And I feel really proud in how our government bodies are making use of it. Only thing is the only point that I would on this note, that more collaboration, cross-functional, cross-departmental collaboration would be needed for these services to come together. The ICC, ICCC, that framework is already there. Now to onboard more and more services there, the whole interdepartmental collaboration would be the need of the hour to actually make it a truly smart and safe city for the citizens.
I'll
hand it over to you.
Great, very well put, Nidhi. I think making services more usable and applicable is the way ahead. We heard a lot of integration, a lot of talk of data in some places, not talking to each other, systems not being able to integrate or talk to each other. I would like to bring in Bhavin. Bhavin, what are your thoughts? How important is the data? Is it a double-edged sword, invasion of privacy, or using it to leverage better governance? Please, your thoughts on it.
Yeah, thanks, Aditya. And once again, I thank the team for having us on this panel discussion. Good afternoon to all of you. Aditya, what you said is correct, but I also have a different view on that. As we hear that data is the new oil, right? So yes, it is two-sided sword, but the more important is how you utilize. And there is no runaway. You will need to keep data to do a lot of things, okay? Data is something will help you decide your future. It is something which will help you to take decisions faster, right? And if you ask me, with the pandemic which started and which is still there, obviously not gone. So we are living in these challenging times. But at the same time, there are interesting technologies around us which can do wonder to us and help create automated, safe and secure world for us, right? So when it comes to data and when it comes how these new technologies will run, okay? So new technologies, when I say like AI, artificial intelligence, machine learning, big data, when you talk about all these things, the underlying infrastructure required, the core for these applications or for these technologies to work is going to be the storage, right? Because these all applications will gather information from different parts of that ecosystem and then give a solution, like other panelists also mentioned, right? Like you give me the data and then let others work on that. So same thing, what this new technologies will do is you will need a lot of data to process and then give a predictable output to that. So we as an organization, when I talk about Western Digital, we are indirectly present in all the storage solutions, starting from IoT devices to the smart city surveillance solutions. Okay, we are part of a building block for this entire ecosystem of the storage being used in this smart cities area, right? And I would say 5G is something which has actually powered these technologies to use and to run at its best, right? So with this, you can do more predictable analysis. You can do, it can be much in advance and it can be more accurate. Yes. So coming towards the technology and coming towards the storage, what is required to deliver these solutions, best part is all the storage companies are delivering and every day they are into development things, and they are coming up with large capacities to meet the world requirement to store this data. Now, just let me give you one example of automated car, right? Like today autonomous car, I would say. So autonomous car is something that in every day it is going to generate 1 terabyte of data. Now, when it is going to generate 1 terabyte of data, I'm sure it cannot store that data on that car itself for the long time. So that car needs to be connected. So all this collaboration of large amount of storage available at the back end, the 5G connectivity is going to help drive these solutions like autonomous car, like the decisions to be made on to work this kind of technologies for which you will be using AI, ML and things like that. So this all is integrated, and obviously data is going to play a key role into this. So I'm sure I was able to bring some point towards why data and where it is, why it is going to be so important. Thanks.
Definitely. Data is going to be one of the pivotal aspects of technology and the transformation. Vivek, would like you to chip in with your vast experience into transport. We heard so many initiatives in the domain. Can you throw some light on how do you see this going ahead, whether it is, you know, integrating all these transport initiatives, how tech can be leveraged, and how cities can grow? Over to you, Vivek.
Thanks, Aditya. See, I think, let me have a perspective first. It was a fantastic, information being given by all the cities. What last 5 years have predominantly done is that it has brought administration in the cities and service providers to think alike. That is the biggest advantage. Today, if you see, the CEOs of the smart cities are so well informed about why technology, for what use the technology can be deployed, and what are the benefits that we can deliver to our citizens. I think this is the biggest change that we are seeing, when government and industry works together to deliver for user experiences. Where it has to go tomorrow is important. I think, all of us now understand what can technology deliver for us. Tomorrow is going to be how collaboratively is this technology delivering from cross-functional experience. For example, I agree with Sarita ma'am that while we have implemented technology, what are the downstream effects that it has delivered? And how are different safe and smart technologies talking to each other and delivering cross-functional experiences? For example, when we say there is a CCTV camera on bus, and we are able to, identify activities, whether that is somebody is stealing something there, there's unlawful activity or something else. Can this be linked to some other data which makes it more meaningful and brings in agility as far as decision making is concerned? I think it's very important to look at how are insights going to play out in terms of better and smarter decisions that people at ground can take. Administration does use this data at the top level for a lot of decision making. But if you really see people on ground who are supposed to take these decisions every second minute, look at a traffic cop on the junction, right? That person needs more real-time information than anybody else. You can't have junctions across the city everywhere, but could we now create some capabilities for this person who is there on the junction to make him take smarter decisions? I think we are at a point where this technology has to start making sense to people in a multi, decision environment. Traffic is, a derivative of a lot of social thinking. Oftentimes we are asked a question, why are we seeing so much of cars on the roads all the time when we are trying to augment public transport in many ways, and we are trying to make smarter infrastructure in our cities. So we go back to our socio-economic considerations. We are a growing economy. We are a growing country. We have growing aspirations, lower middle class going to middle class, and so on and so forth. And the first thing one really looks at is buying a car. Now, that's not essentially wrong, but then how do we discourage it to be used every day is more important. And hence, how can we make this inclusivity, quality, availability, accessibility more profound in our integrated way of thinking in our cities? That is probably to me, which is going to be the next important step that the city should start with. Hope that makes sense.
Great. That's a pertinent point, Vivek. We'll have to see how we can make it more collaborative and more usable for everyone. With this, I think we have heard from everyone. It's enriching to know so many cities doing so many initiatives. I would like to quickly hear from everyone what, in probably one or two sentences or probably in a shorter thought, what's the way ahead? How do you think this digital transformation will drive governance in each of your cities or departments and domains? Starting with Sarita ma'am, if you could tell us your thoughts on the way ahead.
Okay, so coming right to the point, you know, I believe that the essential elements to be taken into consideration are the administrators, of course, the IT people who are going to provide the solutions, and not to forget the most important component of the citizens, which comprises the also the beneficiaries largely, although we all are in some of the other sense. So what is required is the administrators need to have a clarity on their role, their functions, and keep the citizen in mind. The final outcome has to be analyzed and assessed by them, and see to it that they know their city very well. So a high-end locality will have different kinds of priorities, and a low-income locality or area is going to have different priorities. Who is going to be the decision maker at the cutting edge is the person who should have that information, that data, rather than going about collecting the data for the sake of it and waiting for a decision, like putting them in a queue that first we do one thing and then we do the other thing. There has to be a comprehensive approach towards the requirements of a section, a locality, and of course, going by the the immediate or the urgent necessities, or we usually are limiting ourselves to responding to the disasters. I don't undermine that. That is very important. That is the utmost job of the government. But as we slowly build a smart city, we should not lose the focus of this, that we should be responsive to the needs of the people as and when they arise in making their lives better. And for the IT people, of course, integration is what is most important, and integrating a diverse range of transformation modules and communication methods across the departments and regions is what they should focus and understand their what they're supposed to deliver through the eyes of the administrators and the people. Thank you, and best wishes to all.
Thank you, ma'am. That was insightful from your end. Adar sir, your closing remarks on way ahead, one initiative or something that you think is going to drive from here on the governance?
I think Sarita ma'am rightly summed it up and pointed it out. I think two things. One is that, technology is not a choice. This is the way forward. The only thing is that, as ma'am was saying, we don't do it serially, that we'll do one thing, we'll do, then we'll go to the other thing. We'll have to create the larger picture and an integrated whole, which ultimately delivers not only in the time of, say, crisis, but as far as the day-to-day, say, services to people are concerned. So that's the objective. Our sense is that Srinagar has been a little late mover in this whole, but I see that to our advantage as of now, because this helps us learn from what other cities have done. So for us, it's going to be way forward. What has worked in other places, what has not, we're heavily banking on that learning, and moving forward. Again, aim would be to ensure that this is a resource, and how to try to find ways in better leveraging and better using these resources in the efficient service delivery as far as the city is concerned. Thank you.
Thank you, Agreed, sir. We as a country will grow by learning from each other. Jayati ma'am, would you like to come in your closing remarks on the way forward, on the key drivers that you think that there are? Jayati ma'am, am I audible? I think we don't have a connection there. Anshul sir, would like to hear from you the way forward, your remarks on those, how we can take it ahead. Okay, probably they're not being connected well. Nidhi, what do you think, what would be the one thing that you think is going to drive digital transformation in this space, if you have to sum it up?
So I think the putting the citizens' need foremost and looking at innovative ways of exploiting cross services data would be what will drive the entire digital transformation in this. And while we talk about smart cities, we really forget about remote areas, or forget about digital inclusivity. Digital inclusivity is another thing that will drive. And just a parting thought on that, while we're talking about it, starting small but not having a siloed approach would be the best way to go forward. Also, not getting locked down into proprietary technologies, because the technology refresh and upgrades happen so fast. It's not the technology procurements scenarios of yesteryears. A technology partner who can match the steps and innovate with them and help them with those journeys and ease out would also be very very critical to the digital transformation here. That's all from my end. Thank you.
Bhavin, you would like to chip in? Any closing comments from your end?
Yeah, I would like to just add one line, and I totally agree with what Nidhi mentioned about not sticking to the proprietary technologies, because eventually that will bring in a lot of limitations. And with the kind of infrastructure and with the kind of pace we are growing and seeing the requirements of smart cities, it is more important to look at open standard solutions where you do not get locked in, you do not get limited to your future expansions. So when you use open technologies, when you use open architecture, the sky is the limit. Look at the infrastructure and the architecture built by the Googles and Facebooks and Amazons of the world. So something on same lines, you can build hybrid models, you can build those the storage infrastructure with open standards. So that is, I would say, it's going to be way forward. And rather than looking at standalone and proprietary solutions, the new smart cities where deployment is in discussion, where deployment may is going to happen, should have a very open vision and a broad vision to look forward for this open standards solutions. Yeah, that's it from my side. Thank you.
Vivek, you would like to add anything?
Yeah, I think much has been already said. I would only say that here is a time when you need to optimize on what you have. You cannot have an endless investments. So I think optimization is the way to go. If you really see what everybody said, was how do we make things more user-oriented, user at the center. Now, there are two type of users. One, we have the end users, and then we have internal users as well. The relevance has to be equally given to both the users. That's one. And second is, I think you would say use less, deliver more is something that is the time, because we all have now, reached an inflection point where we have the critical infrastructure, we understand how it works. Now is the time to use tools and technologies which helps us consolidate our viewpoint internally and deliver value to the users. And hence, I think the value engineering is the phase that one needs to go with right now.
Great. I think great hearing you all. Very pertinent points put forward by everyone. To sum it up, I think it's going to be collaboration what is going to be emphasized on, while leveraging the new tech and creating infrastructure that is long lasting. I think I would like to thank all the esteemed panelists, everyone, Sarita ma'am, Athar sir, Jayati ma'am, Anshul sir, Samir sir, and all the industry players, Nidhi, Vivek, Bhavin. Thank you for being with us. And I'm sure the audience is going back enriched listening to all the viewpoints here today.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ashish.
Thanks, everyone.
Thanks, everyone. Thank you.
Bye. Bye.